Good morning, and welcome to worship with St. Paul's United Methodist Church. As we gather to worship together in our homes all across our community, we rejoice in the opportunity to continue to celebrate and proclaim the good news of the risen Christ. Grace and peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work. Who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Would you join me in the prayer for illumination? Open our hearts and minds, O God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, so that as the word is read and proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us this day. Amen. Our first lesson this morning is from the second chapter of the Acts of the Apostles. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, Brothers, what should we do? Peter said to them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him. And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I love the Lord. Because he has heard the voice of my supplication. Because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I called upon him. The cords of death entangled me. The grip of the grave took hold of me. I came to grief and sorrow. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray you save my life. How shall I repay the Lord for all the good things he has done for me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his servants. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds. I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving. And call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem, hallelujah.
A reading from Peter's first letter. If you invoke his Father, the one who judges all people impartially, according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you are ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You've been born anew, not of perishable, but of an imperishable seed, through the living and enduring Word of God. The Word of the Lord.
The gospel reading is from Luke. Now, on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a mighty prophet in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that he had indeed seen a vision of angels and that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been known to them in the breaking of the bread. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me? Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. I think one of the funniest movies I've ever seen is The Jerk with Steve Martin. It's a story of a guy that is not too bright, but he ends up inventing the optograph. It's this device you use for taking your glasses off and putting them back on again. And he makes a fortune, but then he loses everything because the optograph makes you cross-eyed. Toward the end of the movie, Navin has lost everything that is important to him. He feels like a failure. He has this argument with his wife, and in anger, he says to her, "I don't need you." And he gets ready to leave, but before he leaves, he starts this litany of sorts, and he says, I don't need anything except this ashtray, and he picks up this ashtray. "I don't need anything except this ashtray and this chair," and he picks up the chair. And he continues like this until his arms are full of useless things. It is a picture of hopelessness, and he's reaching for something to hold on to and finding all the wrong things. What would you pick up if you lost all hope? And even though we laugh at that scene, it shows a man who is down and out and brokenhearted and disillusioned. And as I thought about that, I flashed back to this passage in Luke 24, where two followers of Jesus are trudging down the Emmaus Road. Their hopes have been crushed. Their dreams have been destroyed. Their leader has been crucified. These two disciples are the picture of the walking wounded, when suddenly they get a new lease on life. And this is how the story goes. It's early in the afternoon. Cleopas and another man that tradition tells us was named Simon, they've been followers of Jesus, but now they have thrown in the towel. They have quit, and they are trudging down the Emmaus Road like these broken and defeated warriors. Now, they know about the crucifixion. They saw it with their own eyes, but they've not yet heard about the resurrection. They've not yet experienced the risen Christ. And so they're disappointed and disillusioned and heartbroken, and they trudge down the Emmaus Road toward home. Their hopes for the future have been ruined. So not knowing what else to do, they turn back towards their old life. Can you see them in your mind? I mean, I picture them as their shoulders are slumped and their heads are bowed, and it's as though they carry on their backs this heavy burden of defeat and sadness. And they limp along with these weary steps as if their shoes are made of lead. Maybe their eyes are misted over with tears. And they walk along in silence because they don't even know what to say to each other. And then maybe as they're walking along, one of them sighs and begins to speak. He's dead. He's gone. It's all over. They've killed him, and without him we are nothing. We should have known this wouldn't have worked. It was too good to be true. It was too idealistic for this cruel world. How could we be such fools? We followed him. We trusted him. We thought he was the one who would save us. And now, well, now it's all over. Now that's the picture of a broken spirit, down and defeated and wounded. But you and I, we know that this is not the end of the story. That the risen Christ comes to them, and he walks with them, talks with them. He opens the scriptures to them. He breaks bread with them. And as they experience the resurrection Christ, look what happens. They get resurrected too. They are healed. They find new life. And then they rush. Well, they run back to Jerusalem to share the good news with the other disciples. They run back shouting, "Hope is alive. Christ is risen. Christ is alive." Isn't that a great story? There are so many powerful images and dramatic symbols there. It's packed full of the stuff of life. There's great lessons in there for us. And we could go in so many different directions, but for today, in these crazy times that we're living in, I want to lift up a few things that really show the good news that's found here. The good news for you and I. One of the things we learn is that Christ comes to us in a special way when we're hurting. I mean, Christ is always with us in every circumstance in life. But over the years, I've noticed that it seems he draws even closer to us when we're in pain. Cleopas and Simon were hurting that day as they trudged down the Emmaus Road. And then suddenly Christ was there with them to give them strength and to meet their needs. And that's the way it works. It seems like it would be easy for us to feel the presence of Christ when everything is great and going well and all that is happening well. But the truth is that Christ is never nearer to us than when we're hurting. Time after time, I've heard people say something like, this is the hardest thing we've ever gone through. Our hearts are broken, but we're going to be all right because God is with us as never before. So many times I hear hurting people say, "I know that God is with us." God is uniquely and especially with us when we're hurting. And I think there's two reasons for that. I think, first of all, it's because we are more open to the presence of God when we're down and out. And second, I believe that God is like a loving parent who wants to be especially close to God's children when they are in pain. Every parent knows what I'm talking about. This is an important lesson that we see in this gospel story, that Christ comes to us in a special way when we're hurting. And then we also learn that Christ has the power to heal our hurts. In Luke 24, we see how it happens. Cleopas and Simon are trudging along with this broken spirit, but then Christ comes to them, and remember what he does? He walks with them, symbolizing the importance of our daily walk with Christ. He talks with them, showing the power of prayer. He opens the scriptures to them, highlighting the importance of our Bible reading. He breaks bread with them, an obvious plug for Holy Communion or sharing together, maybe even in a love feast. And then he sends them back to church. I mean, look at this. Prayer, Bible study, the sacraments, staying close to the church, and a daily walk with Jesus Christ. Through these holy habits, what John Wesley called the means of grace, Christ can bring healing to our broken spirits. But here's the other thing I think we learn in this story. and that's that Christ shares his resurrection with us. You see, when we experience the risen Christ, then we, like Cleopas and Simon, well, we get resurrected too. We get new life. Bishop Ellis Finger once told the story of a first grade school teacher who was having a horrible day. And maybe you can relate a little bit, as many of you are also serving as teachers these days. Well, it had rained all that day, and 27 first graders had been cooped up in a small classroom all day long with no recess, and the children were absolutely wild. The teacher couldn't get them calmed down. Seemed like there was one problem after another all day long, and she was beside herself, and really she was more anxious than the children were for the 3 o'clock bell to ring and end the school day. At 2:45, the teacher looked out the window and she noticed that it was still raining outside, so she began the long task of getting the right raincoats and the right rain hats and the right rain boots on the right children. Finally, she had them all fixed and ready to go, except for one little six-year-old boy. He had a pair of boots that were just impossible to get on. No zippers, no snaps, no buttons. They had to be pulled on with lots of effort. And the teacher pushed and pulled and yanked and jerked and tugged until they finally slipped on, and she was so relieved. But then the little boy said, "Teacher, you know what? These boots aren't mine." Well, the teacher wanted to scream, but she didn't. She said a quick prayer and took a deep breath and pushed her hair back out of her face and began the difficult process of getting the boots back off of the little boy. She pulled and jerked and yanked and tugged, and finally the boots came off. And then the boy said to her, "They're my sister's, but she lets me wear them." Now, the resurrection is not ours. It belongs to Jesus Christ, but he lets us wear it. And when we strap on the boots of Christ, when we follow his teachings, when we commit ourselves to continue Christ's ministry of love, when in faith we accept him, then we become whole, and our broken places are healed, and our hope is restored, and we really come alive. And then that scripture, that wonderful story, goes on and says, "When they came to Emmaus, he acted as if he was going on ahead. But they urged him, saying, 'Stay with us. It's nearly evening and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. After he took his seat at the table with them, he took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened and they recognized him, but he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, 'Weren't our hearts on fire when he spoke to us along the road and when he explained the scriptures for us?' They got up right then and returned to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying to each other, 'The Lord has risen. He appeared to Simon.' Then the two disciples described what had happened along the road and how Jesus was made known to them as he broke the bread." This is a great reminder that Jesus Christ is alive, and through him, so are we. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you join me as we affirm our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
With a faith that transcends all circumstances and has stood throughout the generations, let us go to God in prayer. Risen and glorious God, we turn to you today rejoicing in the way that you appeared to your disciples. You visited your disciples on the road to Emmaus, and you broke bread with them when evening came. Your words of peace and blessing opened the eyes of those disciples who couldn't quite yet see you through the chaos of their grief and loss, through their doubt and pain. Continue to open our hearts and our eyes to you. May your miraculous actions wake us to a new reality. May your life-giving love fill our hearts, that when we are slow to recognize you, or when we are reluctant to believe, fill us with joy again. Fill us with a joy that comes from the assurance that Jesus Christ has broken the power of sin and death forever. Holy God, we place our lives in your hands. Reveal to us the ways you work in our lives and in the lives of our neighbors. Show us signs of grace even in the midst of difficulty. Help us to see the new light you are bringing even now. And when we cannot identify your goodness in the world around us and in our own lives, give us faith to believe. Enable us to trust you. May your resurrecting power strengthen us to move boldly into the world that you love, and teach us to be a blessing to those who we encounter along the road of life and find you in the fellowship of a table. O God of resurrection, by your mighty power, you have broken the hold of sin and death. By your miraculous power, renew our world and mold us according to your will. Holy God, when we grow impatient with restrictions and the changes in our lives, grant us an extra measure of that patience we desire. As our restlessness increases, turn our attention from what we don't have into what we do have. Help us to remember and to pray for those in need. We pray especially for those experiencing violence around the world and here at home, for those experiencing the violence of massive loss in the job market. Draw our focus out of ourselves so that we may see the world that you love and enable us to share your love with it. Enlivening Spirit, when Jesus appeared to his disciples on that road, he offered words of peace and friendship. We need your peace within us and amongst us now. May your peace be with all those who bravely serve in hospitals and clinics, in grocery stores and food banks, in patrol cars and fire trucks. Holy Spirit, breathe your peace into those having trouble who are breathing, whether it is caused by a virus or anxiety. May your peace be with those whose tempers are prone to violent words and actions, and bring your peace to those whose faith is shaken or forgotten, or for those whose faith is just beginning to grow. Comforting Spirit, bring your peace to all who are dying and all who are grieving. O God of new life and eternal life, we offer to you our prayers, both spoken and those that remain in our hearts, trusting that you hear each one. In the name of the risen Christ, we pray the prayer that Christ has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. I invite you now to share signs of peace with those who have gathered around with you in your living rooms and in your homes, to send texts and words of grace and peace to all those who you love.
I want to welcome you again to St. Paul's United Methodist Church. We're so glad that you are worshiping with us today. I want to let you know that there you can register on the app or on our live stream page. And if it's your first time with us, be sure and let us know how to get in touch with you, tell you about all the great things happening here at St. Paul's. couple announcements I wanted to lift up to you all today. I wanted to tell you that we've got a blood drive coming up on Thursday, April the 30th. It'll go from 10 to 2 in the Jones Building. You need to sign up to go and do that. You can go to our webpage and find a sign up for that, or you can contact Reverend Andrew Wolf and he'll let you know how to get signed up. Also want to tell you we're still accepting donations for the Emergency Aid Coalition. Some of their needs are fresh fruit, things like peanut butter crackers and trail mix. They're accepting donations at Abraham Station Monday through Friday from 9 to 1. There's also a book drive going on for children's books, and they're looking for used or new books to help families during this homeschooling period. You can drop off the books at the Jones Building Monday through Thursday from 10 to 3, or you can contact Reverend Paul Richards Kwan and he can give you more information about that. Our healing circles are continuing, and there's one on social distancing support that meets on Wednesdays from 10 to 11 a.m. on Zoom. You can contact Helen Spa and she can give you some more information about that. All of classes and choirs and things are all meeting, and all that information is on our website. You can get some more information about that as well. I want to turn it over to Tiffin Wills for now, our Director of Youth Ministries, for a word about our 2020 confirmation class.
Good morning. Today is the day we had scheduled for Confirmation Sunday, a very special day in which our confirmation students would be standing before you in a white robe. Their parents, their family, and you as a congregation would be behind them, supporting them. Their names would be called, and they would come forward, and they would kneel at the altar, in which clergy and staff and parents would lay hands upon them, and they would be confirmed into full membership of the church. It is such a special day that we have chosen to wait and do so in person as a congregation, so that we can all support them fully. Today, we want to recognize the dedication and commitment that the 2020 confirmation class has made in the process that began back in September. I want to say a special word of thank you to the parents that have supported them and encouraged them throughout this process. You have gotten them to class, to retreats, to other places to worship, and as of recent, help them log on to Zoom. I want to say a word of thank you to our confirmation teaching team, co-coordinators Mike and Sharon Mosby, teacher Mac McLaren, and Martin Stupel. Thank you for your dedication and support. I also want to thank other youth staff, Oksana Schwach, Kat Denton, and all of our clergy for their continued support. I have been so impressed with this confirmation class, to watch them come in as eager individual learners and to form into a cohesive learning group. Thank you, all students, for your commitment and your time, and we look forward to journeying with you as your faith continues. Our 2020 confirmation students: Rachel Anderson, Lyndon Beebe, Winston Beebe, Julia Beach, Catherine Doe, Lulu Flores, Paul Gao, Jacob Gunn, Noah Gunn, Kiara Heath, Blake Henry, Lucy Holt, Elizabeth Jouse, Reed Curtis, Will Lane, Madeline Molina, Sophia Marcelio, Emma Mudd, William Plant, Georgia Mustachio, John Sharp, Mallory Taylor, Ella Taylor, Sarah Van Landingham, Corbin Warner, Sophia Watson, Victoria Weiser, Mark Wheeler, Adam Wilson, and Charlotte Witz. Congratulations on your confirmation process.
Thank you, Tiffin, for sharing that information and the confirmation kids' names. It was a great confirmation class. I was able to teach a few of the lessons. Lene and I worshiped with them via Zoom at their virtual retreat. It's a great group that you all can be very proud of, part of our St. Paul's family. I'm thankful for your continued generosity that allows our programming like Confirmation to continue in these times. There's all sorts of ways that you can give. You can set up recurring giving. You can give through text to give. You can still mail in checks. All that information is found on the app and the website. During the offertory today, which is an amazing gift by the St. Paul's Treble Choir, I hope you'll be prayerful about how God is calling you to be a cheerful giver. Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you for the ways that you're working in our lives, and we thank you for all those in these days who are out on the front lines to work in healing ways during this time. We pray, oh God, that you would help us remember the blessings that we have, and that you would make us cheerful givers as we return a portion to you, so that your work might be complete here on earth. Amen.
Jesus is Lord of all.
And now would you receive this benediction? And now may the risen Christ go with you. May he be beside you to walk with you. May he be in front of you to guide you. May he be above you to watch over you. But most of all, may he be within you. Amen.